Okay, yeah, good. Okay, so I'm going to continue the discussion of symmetry fractionalization, in particular gauging a model with global symmetry into a gauge theory. Okay. So yesterday we just looked at the simplest example where we had an Ising power magnet, the simplest Hamiltonian you can think of, and couple it to the Z2 gauge field and arrive at a different Hamiltonian. So it contains terms that is inherited from the original Hamiltonian and also has terms which involves the gauge field. Okay, so yesterday after class, I got a lot of good questions. So I want to come back a little bit to this transformation from a model with global symmetry to a model with gauge symmetry and make a few more comments. So first of all, well, for this model, it's too trivial. But you might notice that the part involving the matter field, this part of the Hamiltonian, doesn't quite change. So even though we put in Rahul's term with Ising coupling, Rahul coupling, we would have an extra term that looks like even though we're putting terms like that, if you only look at this part of the Hamiltonian compared with the original one, they have the same spectrum. Basically, what we did is to throw in some tau z's. And the tau z's, they don't affect the algebra among all the terms in this part of the Hamiltonian. So the terms look a little bit different, and the degrees of freedom are more, but the algebra is the same. And the commutation relations are the same. So if the commutation relations are same, the algebras are same, that's saying the spectrum is the same. So if we started from a gap Hamiltonian, we get a gap Hamiltonian for this part. If we started from a gapless one, we get a gapless one. This is just saying that coupling to a gauge field doesn't change the spectrum of the matter part of the model. Okay. And well, you might say, why does this matter? Because this is only part of the Hamiltonian, we have other parts. But it turns out the other parts, they commute with this part as well. That's by design. Because this part is the local symmetry, and we change the Hamiltonian in such a way such that it commutes with all local symmetries. It satisfies all local symmetries. So this part doesn't affect the spectrum of the modified Hamiltonian. And this part is the flux term. The flux term is a bunch of products of tau z's in the basis of the gauge field. And this is also diagonal in that basis, so they also commute. So this flux term and this Gauss law term both commute with the modified Hamiltonian. So the modified Hamiltonian is indeed the spectrum is preserved. We just have some extra structure related to charge. Gauge charge and gauge flux. Yes?
And later, you're replacing an excitation from the left-hand side from the matter field by an excitation of the gauge flux.
Yeah, right. Okay, yesterday I did that. And the reason I did that is to make the model look exactly like Torrey code, because everyone would recognize it. And yesterday I can do that also because the model is simple. In general, I don't think you can do that. So yeah, for example, you have gapless matter field, and you couple them to some Z2 gauge field. I don't think you can just throw away the matter field. So usually, what I have to do is to keep everything here, keep the modified Hamiltonian, keep the flux term, keep the charge term, keep the Gauss law term, and look at them as a whole. Yeah, yesterday, this model is particularly simple that I can throw away this thing. Yeah. Okay. Right. So the spectrum of the matter field doesn't change, but also there are extra structures related to the gauge flux and the gauge charge. And we can see how that works out because in this case, the gauge charge and gauge flux we know from Toriko that we can just use string operators and create excitations in this plaquette and that plaquette or at this vertex or that vertex, right? So this is pretty much the structure that works for all gauge, discrete gauge theories, that you write down these kind of terms, and then you find a string operator that can create excitations in the gauge field, either violating the flux constraint or violating the Gauss law constraint, the charge constraint. But of course, the statistics can change. And in particular, so in this case, it's particularly simple. For example, if we want to violate the plaquette term, we add a bunch of tau x terms on all these links, right? And they only violate plaquette here and plaquette here and create two flux. Yeah, if we have this term, we need to be a little more careful with how we design the string operator. Let's forget about Rahul again. Right. And if we want to create charge excitation, what we do is we do a bunch of tau z and on a string like that. And they're exactly the Toriko'd like string operator. Okay. But of course, not for every model the string operator can look this simple, right? For example, if we have some more complicated matter field, not something in the Ising paramagnetic phase, something like an SPT, we can have a two-dimensional SPT symmetry protected topological phase with Z2 symmetry. There's just one non-trivial phase, and if we put that kind of matter field here, we'll have a modified term here, right? And that modified term would involve tau z. And then if we try to write down string operator like that, it doesn't work. We somehow need to modify the string operator, and you would see that the modification to the string operator is such that the statistics of the string operator changes. The exchange statistics of two fluxes changes, and that's how this statistics of the gauge flux is related to the order of the original matter under the symmetry. Okay. It's exactly because we need a string operator to commute with everything in the middle, every other term along the path. And if this kind of term involves tau z, then we need to modify the string operator. But the modification in that case will change the statistic. If we just put in this term, very small, we also need to modify the string operator, but that doesn't change the statistics. Well, I can't show you right now because I don't know how to modify it, but it should work because if this term is small, it's just the same Ising paramagnetic phase. Okay. Right. So another thing I want to comment also came about from question yesterday is that because this part of the spectrum is exactly the same as the original Hamiltonian, and also these parts, they both commute with the modified Hamiltonian, and they also commute with themselves. So the gap of this Hamiltonian close only if the gap of this Hamiltonian close. So if we want to compare two Hamiltonians on this side, and H0 and H1, and we design a path connecting them, okay? And suppose that along this whole path, we keep the global symmetry. And then if we want to know that if these two are in the same phase, we want to look at if this Hamiltonian along the path can have a gap all the time, right? And that translates into this gauged Hamiltonian being gapped all the time and having a gapped path connecting them, right? Because the spectrum, if this is gapped, this is gapped, and vice versa. So, and this is why we can distinguish, let's say, SPT phases by gauging them and trying to see if they result in the same gauge theory. And similarly, we can take a symmetry enriched topological phases, whatever phase with global symmetry. And if we want to tell if two phases belong to, if two Hamiltonians belong to the same phase, we can gauge them and see if they belong to the same gauge theory sector. Okay.
Any indication for the gauging procedure? Because you just mentioned this is a way to tell a lot of
What do you mean, limitation?
So I guess here you provide one. I imagine I can do something very, very complicated, but I'm just curious to question how do we properly perform such.
Oh, okay. Right. So I showed you this simple Hamiltonian with one body term and two body terms, right? And you might ask, what if I have very complicated Hamiltonians, right? So first of all, you need a local Hamiltonian, and you need a Hamiltonian with global symmetry. But I think that's it. And then this part is totally standard, and this part is totally standard, right? So the only part you need to care about is how to modify the Hamiltonian such that it satisfies the local symmetry. And that can always be done. Let's say you have a full body term, sigma x, sigma y. I'm just writing things in random order. Okay, so this is a full body term. It still satisfies the Z2 symmetry, right? Because this one, there's a minus one here, and globally still is invariant under this tau x symmetry. And we want to put in gauge field such that it is invariant on all local symmetries. And the way you can do that is to put gauge field tau z here, because there's a symmetry charge here and a symmetry charge here. We just put gauge field to connect them. Okay, and you can also do it this way. It's totally equivalent because of this term. Okay, so yes.
I guess I'm still a little confused. So you're saying that if H1 and H2 are two Hamiltonians, H1 prime and H2 prime are the gauge version. You're saying if H1 prime and H2 prime are the same phase, then H1 and H2 are.
Yeah, when they're all gapped.
But you know, the operation of gauging is not a smooth operation, so are you relying here on some duality between the theory and the gauge version?
So I'm relying on the fact that if the original Hamiltonian is gapped, then the gauge one is gapped. Yeah. And this I just argue because of the commutivity of all the Hamiltonian terms.
I guess I don't see that the Hamiltonian and this gauge version are in the same phase, because when you gauge it, you're not
there's a map from a path in Hamiltonian space pre-gauging, there's a map to a corresponding path post-gauging. And if there's no transition in the first path, there can't be.
And this map is one-to-one, so
yeah.
Not necessary. Mm-hmm. So in that case, I don't see how being in the same phase is gauge sector.
It is well. I'm talking about a pretty unique way of gauging. This one has more degrees of freedom, so it has more gauge flux, gauge charge sector. But this part of the spectrum is same, and this part of the spectrum is also gapped, and it's just something extra. I'm just so if this is gapped, then this is gapped. So if the whole path here is gapped, then the whole path here is gapped. So if we're only talking about phases in gapped system, then if the original two are in the same phase, then the latter two are and also so in the same phase.
If the first one is gapless, the second one is also gapless?
This two?
If H naught is gapless, H1 would be gapless too?
Well, that's not necessary. I'm just saying that if I stay within gapped phases, if I only consider gapped Hamiltonian, and I can find a gapped path connecting to gapped Hamiltonian.
But it may still happen that H0 goes through a transition and H1 does not, what you just said. But H0 could go through a gapless point in
yeah.
the parameter space, and H1 will remain gapped.
Yes, that's totally true.
So mapping between phases is not one-to-one. Mapping between distinct phases.
Okay, so my understanding is that you're saying this one may be gapped, right? And this one may be gapped, but at some point the gap may become zero, right? If that's the case, then that also happens here. If I follow this procedure, then gap is non-zero at a 2 point, and gap is zero at some point in the middle. Then there's just nothing I can say about whether they're in the same phase or not. I need to find a better path. Or in the other case, these two are indeed in different phases, and I have to go through a phase transition at some point. Okay, so let me draw this. This is the logic. So this is the original Hamiltonian. This is the final Hamiltonian. And they're gapped. And to determine whether two gapped Hamiltonian are in the same phase, what we can do is to try to find a gapped path of Hamiltonian. If this succeeds, if we can find a path of Hamiltonian continuously connecting H0 to H1, and it stays gapped all the time and satisfying the global symmetry all the time, then these two are in the same phase. That's definition. And you can show that the property of this one and this one are pretty much the same. Okay, and another thing I'm relying on is the fact that if this Hamiltonian is gapped, then upon gauging, the prime Hamiltonian, the gauge Hamiltonian, is also gapped. So if this one is gapped, then this one is also gapped. Then I can find a continuous path connecting this Hamiltonian to this Hamiltonian without closing gap, without phase transition. So this is just saying that I start from two Hamiltonians with global symmetry in the same phase. I end up with gauge theories gauge theories of the same gauge group in the same phase. Yes.
If H0 and H1 are not in the same phase, which means H of T goes to a gapless point.
Right.
Does it imply that H of prime and H of prime are not the same?
Yes. Yes.
It also implies
yes.
Right? Because if you permute charge of the
flux. Oh, yeah, right. Thank you. Yeah, thank you. I was only thinking about the simplest case. Okay, yeah. There are situations where you gauge this one and gauge this one. The gauge theory looks different, but actually they're the same. There can be mappings such that they're the same. Even though there are gapless points in the middle, it's just saying that I can find a path where the gap closed in the middle, but it's not saying that I cannot find another path where gap doesn't close for the gauge Hamiltonian in the gauge theory. There is a caveat to that. If you fix which one corresponds to which gauge flux and which one corresponds to which gauge charge, then I think that's then there's no ambiguity. Yes. Yeah. If you only look at these two Hamiltonian, then there can be a problem. Yeah. Thanks for that point.
Does the logic apply to gauging both discrete and continuous
symmetry? Continuous symmetry. This is not gap. So. There are some photon modes. Then I cannot be sure. Yeah, I don't know. I think I'm confident about the discrete case. Yeah, thanks. Yes.
It seems like this argument relies on the fact that you can
all set of continuous gates of you not only to gauge H1, but also everything in between. So what you said just before was that weight gain depends on the
You have terms and you modify them.
So how do you guarantee that we have a weight, a consistent way to gauge that you vary?
Oh, you mean as I vary parameters in this Hamiltonian, how can I be sure that the modified Hamiltonian also change continuously? Is that okay?
Even at the term.
Yes.
Right. So how do you guarantee that there's this way to
right. Okay. So let's say that for H naught, this ZZ coupling term is zero, and I continuously tune up to some finite amount, right? So for H naught prime, I don't have this term. And then as I go along the path, the coefficient gradually increase from zero. Yeah, so it's still continuous. It's just changing the weight in front of this term.
No, but you can choose in advance, you know, like all possible terms up to some range. You can just specify in advance how you're going to gauge them, whether they're in the Hamiltonian or not. I mean, even if they're zero, you have to imagine you specify your procedure.
Yeah. So you just imagine that, yeah, I think what Mike is saying that, yeah, you just imagine you already have this term, but for some parameter of t, this coefficient is zero, and then at certain point, it becomes non-zero and increase after that. It's just replacing certain terms with other terms, and the weight of the terms, they're exactly the same. So this is j and this is j.
Maybe can I ask you a clarifying question? So mm-hmm. Are we going to use this we're going to use this to tell when H naught and H one are definitely in different phases, right?
Uh-huh.
That's what we're going to use this to do.
Yes.
So maybe it's helpful to explain the logic, like how you use this to do that.
Oh, okay.
Thing, right.
Yeah, thank
this
you.
Sort of like in this diagram, we sort of say, let's suppose H naught and H one are in the same phase. But this is also very useful as a way to tell that H1 and H1 cannot be in the same phase.
Exactly, right? Yes. Okay. Yeah, that's a great point. So let me just use the example of Z2SPT. So in two dimension with Z2 symmetry, well, there's Ising paramagnetic phase. There's also an SPT phase, which has gapless boundaries. Protected by Z2 symmetry. So if we start from an H naught of the trivial one, let me just label it by this is Ising Z2 and H1, which is the SPT, of course, the non-trivial SPT Z2. Okay, and if we gauge them, we get two gauge series. This one I showed yesterday, this is toric code. This one I didn't show, but Michael Levin is coming, so I don't need to show that. this is double Samuel. And this actually is already enough to tell that this Ising Z2 paramagnetic phase is a different phase from the non-trivial SPT. Of course, saying non-trivial is already, now we know it, but this gauging procedure also tells us that, because in toric code, what we know is that the gauge charge is a boson, the gauge flux is a boson, and there's a composite, which is a fermion. And in a double semion theory, the gauge charge is still a boson, but the gauge flux is a semion, meaning that if you take two of gauge flux, exchange them, you get a phase factor of I. And if you do a full braiding, you get a phase factor of minus one. So this is a semion. And their composite is a semion with a minus sign. So this topological spin is I, this topological spin is minus I. Okay. And this is enough to tell that these two are in different topological phases, because the statistics are different, right? There's no way to connect two different topological phases with different statistics. So if you design a path connecting these two, then the gap has to close at a certain point. Yes?
So say we have two different editing procedures for SPD that contribute SPD. This one on the right side.
What do you mean two different gauging procedures?
Maybe not in this case, but for example, in the case with four sigmas,
okay, yeah.
So say we have some situation. Is there a belief that no matter which one we choose, the characters of the quasi particles as well, sometimes as well?
Yes. So this is actually the equivalence of putting gauge coupling this way and gauge coupling this way is guaranteed by this term. Because the product of these two gauge fields is exactly the same as the product of these two gauge fields. Similarly, for this Ising coupling terms, I can also choose to couple them on a longer path, like tau z, tau z, tau z. I don't have to choose the minimum path. But that's totally equivalent, because the difference between the two paths is always a closed loop. And as long as there's no flux in any loop, then I'm safe. So you can replace this term with this term, but as long as there's this term, they're exactly the same as a Hamiltonian. So this is even on a Hamiltonian level, they're just the same thing. It's not even saying that they're in the same phase or something. They're just this Hamiltonian produces the same ground state and produce the same gap. Right. Okay.
Yes. H0 and H1 connected. Why did you use those two?
All right. I haven't come back yet. So this is the logic of how we're going to use it. We're going to take two system with global symmetry, gauge them, and look at the gauge theory. And if we can see that the gauge theory has different statistics for the quasi-particles, then we know that the gauge theory represents different topological order. They cannot be connected by a gapped path, and the gap has to close at some point. And this, from here, we can say that gap has to close at some point for the original model, if we want to keep the global symmetry. So this arrow is this direction, and this arrow is this direction, because if gap is always open for the model with symmetry, then we can guarantee that the gap is always open for the gauge theory. And here, it's the opposite. We go from bottom to up to top, but it's from the fact that the gap closes at some point, has to always close at a certain point, then we can say that for the ones with global symmetry, the gap has to close at a certain point. So these two are like, I don't know what's the English name for it. They're like equivalent.
It's the contrapositive.
All right, right, right. Yes. Okay. Yes, so this is the kind of logic that we'll use to study either SPTs or symmetry enriched topological phases.
That procedure is just easier to do.
It's one way to do it. So, like for example, for SPTs, if you don't couple to gauge field, the way that we can tell that an SPT is different from another SPT is by looking at the edge states. And we need to show that the edge states has to be, well, in 2D, the edge state has to be gapless unless symmetry is broken. And that is not always very easy to show. Yeah, if you have some helical edge theory, even that can be dangerous. Even with free fermion description of edge theory, that can be dangerous because there can be the anomaly hidden in the field theory description. Sometimes can be very confusing. For example, like we know there are broken down of classification from the free fermion case to interacting case. Yeah, the free fermion classification, if you add interaction, it breaks down to some smaller set of phases. So if you want to tell whether a low energy theory on the surface or on the edge is really stable to any kind of symmetric perturbation on the surface or on the edge, that is not something very easy to see. Yeah. Yes. Right. That's a good question. That I don't think you can do from here, because if you don't have global symmetry, this connection breaks. You can't gauge it. And there's right. Yeah, I think he's trying to say that if we explicitly break symmetry, we indeed can connect these two phases, and that I think you cannot see from here. But regarding spontaneously breaking symmetry, then yes. So if symmetry is spontaneously broken at some point and we gauge it, we actually get a confined gauge theory. So that we saw yesterday, we actually stared at a Hamiltonian with only this term and this term and this term, and see that it's indeed a non-topological phase. So if along this path, you see that at a certain point, it becomes non-topological. There are no quasi-particle, there are no ground state degeneracy on torus. Now we know that correspondingly, there's spontaneous symmetry breaking in the original Hamiltonian. Yes?
For example, there's no path that's no gap path between a zero ice and a zero
Yes, that's a good question. I'm not exactly sure. I need to think about it. I think the example Mike gave is one where the gauge theories are connected if you permute some labeling of the gauge flux. And in that sense, we can connect H prime naught to H prime 1. But of course, H naught and H 1 are different. But on the other hand, if you fix the labeling of gauge flux and gauge charge and ask the same question, I don't want to say for sure, because this process of gauging is pretty clear, but the process of ungauging, I don't really know.
It might be true to put some restrictions on the kind of path you're going to down below.
Yeah.
But in general, it's probably doesn't work. But
yeah, I need to think more about it. Yeah. Yes.
I think there are examples where two different SPTs correspond to the same gauge theory after gauging without any connection of the gauge flux.
Really?
That happens when before gauging, the difference between the two SPTs comes from the symmetry between the flux. If the difference in the symmetry identification can be related by gauge,
What do you mean symmetry implementation in the original theory?
For example,
Okay, I'm not sure I understand your example, but maybe we can talk about it later. Yeah, and yeah, if I understand it, maybe I can talk about it in the next lecture. Okay, but maybe we can move on for now. Okay, thanks. Right, am I? Okay, so this is just about how to use the process of gauging to distinguish systems with global symmetry. Right. Where's my? Oh, over there. Okay. Okay. So yesterday I talked about this correspondence between symmetry charge and gauge charge. I just want to make the comment that this is not only true for the simplest Ising paramagnetic model with only the sigma x term. It's true in general. It's basically true because of this term, because this gauge flux term, this Gauss law term. This Gauss law term is basically saying that the gauge charge is you take a symmetry charge and you dress it with some hairs of electric field. And so the electric field only dresses up the symmetry charge, but the statistics properties, whether it's a boson or it's a fermion, just carries over from the model with global symmetry. So symmetry charge is corresponds to gauge charge, and the statistics carry over. Okay, so another point I want to talk about today is symmetry defect. Well, I should say symmetry flux corresponds to gauge flux. Okay. So gauge flux, we saw what it is. Gauge flux is the violation of this term. Okay. And if we want to go back to symmetry flux, we can do something called gauge fixing. We can fix the gauge field in the tau z basis to a particular configuration. Okay. And well, the simplest configuration satisfying that no flux constraint is just where the gauge field is all zero under tau z. So imagine we have a square lattice. And one particular gauge configuration in the tau z basis satisfying the no flux constraint is everywhere zero, right? And of course, by gauge fixing, we're violating this this term, because this term tends to generate non-zero gauge field. But that's the price we pay. So we get rid of the gauge and the Gauss law term and gauge fix, and get a particular configuration of the gauge field. Okay. And then we can see what gauge flux means. Okay. Gauge flux is saying that if I multiply around this circle, the flux is 1. If I multiply around this circle, the flux is 1. So if we change the gauge field configuration, we need to take out all the gauge fields on this path and replace them with 1. Okay, now we get a gauge flux here and a gauge flux here. Okay, and if you, you can literally calculate the flux around the circle and see that this is 1, this is 1, and everywhere else it's 0. Okay, but what does this mean for the modified Hamiltonian? Let's take the modified Hamiltonian with Rahu term and see what happens. Of course, this thing doesn't change. It's the sigma x part. But this term does change. Okay. And for all the terms, for all the sigma z, tau z terms across this link, because the gauge field is 1, so it actually becomes minus sigma z, sigma z. And all the other links, all the white ones, or even this one. All the white ones, they remain the original psi. Okay. So we have a branch cut, and at the end of the branch cut, we have the symmetry flux. And then we take all the terms across the branch cut and add a minus sign. And this is what we mean by a symmetry flux. And it is a symmetry, it is related to symmetry, because this term can be obtained from the original term by applying symmetry on one side of the branch cut. Okay, so we're just conjugating this term with a single sigma x. Okay. And this is how we see that gauge flux correspond to symmetry flux. And symmetry flux is obtained by drawing a fictitious line here and taking all the terms across the cut and conjugating them by symmetry on one half, either inside of the cut or outside of the cut. Well, there's actually no inside and outside, you just take a side and conjugate it. So a much more familiar way of saying this, you must have seen in electronic models where we take hopping terms. Let's say this is a system, and we have some flux here, and what you do is that you take hopping or pairing terms. You take C dagger C or C dagger term and add a phase factor in front, right? And this phase factor is related to how much flux is here in this plaquette and how much flux is here in this plaquette. This is exactly the same procedure, that you take this Hamiltonian term, you conjugate half of it by the U1 symmetry transformation of e to the I to the phi times the number of particles. Because the C dagger changes the quasi-particle by one, so there's an e to the I phi phase factor in front. This is the usual form that we see in free fermion models, but in general for interacting models, we can just do the same. We take a term, cut it in half, and conjugate the half with symmetry transformation.
What is the other term
you want now? Oh, it's a C-dagger. It's a pairing term.
But why is that?
Sorry?
When you still conjugate
only. Yes, I conjugate the C-dagger part. Conjugate this part. Right. Okay, so this is just trying to relate gauge flux to symmetry flux. So in principle, I don't need to do this whole process of gauging. I don't need to go all the way from a symmetric model to a gauged model. I can, in principle, talk about gauge charge. I can, in principle, talk about symmetry charge and symmetry defect. This is actually called something called a G-cross tensor category that you put in all the symmetry defects together with all the original anions and all the original symmetry charges. But it turns out that's a pretty complicated structure, and a lot of the feature can be seen, is embodied by the final gauge theory, which we actually know better about than the G-cross category structure that dealing with all the gauge flux and all the symmetry flux and all the symmetry charges. So that's why we talk about gauging. But of course, there are cases where we cannot gauge, meaning that if there's anomaly, then this gauging procedure just fails. Then we cannot write down a Hamiltonian for the gauged version. What we can do is try to deal with symmetry fluxes and deal with symmetry charges and see if they're compatible, see if they can form a consistent structure. And we actually stop there. We don't get all the way to the gauge theory. So that's why I want to talk about both. The gauge theory is simple because actually we already know a lot about it, and we know in many cases, like in field theory, how to gauge it, how to write down Lagrangian, how to write down Hamiltonian. But once you have anomaly, you actually have to go back to the symmetry flux and think about symmetry flux and symmetry charge and how they play with each other. All right, so a lot of talking, but let me get to examples. Right, so the first way I want to use the gauging procedure is to construct symmetry fractionalization models using gauging. Okay, so I'm going to start from the simplest one. I gave you a homework, which is actually a very complicated one, but I'm going to start from a simple one first. So this is 3. Okay. So let's still take this icing paramagnet model. And we imagine that this icing spin being a two-level system, instead of as a spin, we think of it as describing a Hartkopf boson. Okay, so we have a Hilbert space, an unsigned Hilbert space where we have vacuum, or we have one boson. Okay, so it's a hardcore constraint that we cannot have more than one boson per site. So that's it. So it's a and there are two different configurations here. But then I want to do something to the boson. I don't want it to be just a boring boson. I want it to have some internal structure. For example, it can have some kind of pseudo spin. Okay. I want the boson to have a spin, a pseudo spin, which transform under pseudo spin rotation as a spin 1/2. Okay, so this is just toy model. Don't ask me why boson can have spin 1/2. It's some fictitious degree of freedom. Okay, so. So the boson have some internal degree of freedom, but that's still fine. This Hamiltonian is just saying, I don't want bosons, right? I want vacuum everywhere. So this Hamiltonian is invariant under this pseudo spin rotation symmetry, and it's also invariant under the original Z2 symmetry, which counts the even oddness, well, the number of bosons per lattice site. So we can still do the gauging procedure. We can just pretend that we don't know that the boson has an internal structure, and do the gauging procedure, put in the Z2 gauge field, and arrive at the toric code, and that's pretty much it. And now we have a gauge theory, a Z2 gauge theory with some extra structure, because the gauge charge, which is now this boson, has a pseudo spin structure with it, right? So whenever we create an excitation, whenever there is a boson somewhere in the gauge theory, then there will be electric field lines connecting them. And moreover, each boson has a spin direction. So this is just saying that the gauge charge carries a spin 1/2 fractional quantum number on the pseudo spin rotation. Okay. So it is a Z2 gauge theory. It's a Z2 gauge theory of the torical type, because the topological order is still the same. The Hamiltonian is the same. We gauge it, we get the same topological order. But with the gauge charge, with the gauge charge transforming as pseudo spin 1/2. And the gauge flux, it doesn't care about it. The gauge flux doesn't know that the gauge charge transformed as a pseudo spin 1/2. The gauge flux is just, it doesn't have a pseudo spin quantum number. It's still a boson and pseudo spin 0. so spin zero. So this actually gives us the same symmetry fractionalization pattern as the resonating valence bond model we talked about in the last lecture. It's still Z2 gauge theory, gap Z2 gauge theory with torical type topological order, and the gauge charge transform as some spin 1/2. And in that case, we call it a spin now. And we literally see that it's some spin 1/2 degree of freedom. And the gauge flux is pretty boring. It's a boson and it doesn't have a pseudo spin internal structure. They look very different, but they're the same symmetry enriched topological faces. Yes, Dominic. Oh, okay, that's a good question, yes. So originally, that relates back to the question of, okay, so the question is, we started from matter field that has pseudo spin 1/2 degree of freedom. And then we couple it to gauge field, we see that the gauge charge also have this pseudo spin 1/2. Then how is it considered symmetry fractionalization? Because we start, these are the degrees of freedom in the system. So this goes back to the concept of symmetry fractionalization we talked about in the last lecture, that here, in the original model, we literally can have a single boson, right? We can have one boson sitting in the system as a global excitation, which does carry pseudo spin 1/2. But in the gauge theory, we can only have two boson flipping. So if there are deconfined excitations, we always have two. And because we always have two, so globally, we actually cannot have pseudo spin 1/2. We always have pseudo spin 1, or a pseudo spin integer. And then the pseudo spin 1/2 becomes a fractional quantum number. Yeah, thanks.
Is the eigenvalue, you know, a stateless eigenvalue of sigma plus 1 corresponds to vacuum boson?
Yes. Sorry. This is sigma x equal to 1. Yeah, this is one boson is considered a symmetry charge. Yeah, so if you have the general picture is that if you have a matter field and the matter field carries some quantum number, then it translates into the quantum number for the gauge charge once you gauge it. Okay, so if we start from electrons which have spin 1/2 and we couple it to gauge field, then the gauge charge will have spin 1/2. And the gauge charge being a fermion. Yes. So the sigma x is acting on 1 and then 2. So it's this is the pseudo spin. Okay, now we go to the homework problem. So this is gauging topological superconductor with Z2 gauge field. So let me just remind you again what a topological superconductor is. You can think of it as a P plus IP superconductor on the top layer and a P minus IP superconductor in the bottom layer. And the system has time reversal symmetry. And the time reversal symmetry maps a fermion with spin up to spin down and spin down to minus spin up. Should I write C? No, that's fine. Okay, so time reversal squared is actually what people say t squared equal to minus 1. Okay. And of course, there's a Z2 fermion parity symmetry, which is this minus 1. So this minus 1 is what is usually written in a single particle picture because it's minus 1 on a single particle. But if we want to talk about many body symmetry, I would prefer to replace it with fermion parity. So this is counting the parity of number of fermions. So T squared is actually equal to fermion parity. Okay. This is the symmetry of the system. Okay. So now what we want to do is to gauge the fermion parity part and result in a gauge theory. And the question is, we get a Z2 gauge theory, okay? What kind of Z2 gauge theory it is? And how does the gauge charge and the gauge flux transform under the remaining time reversal symmetry? Because I didn't touch the time reversal symmetry. I only gauged the fermion parity part. Okay. So if you already know the answer before I talk about all this, then please stay quiet. I know there are many experts here. But if you thought about it last night or thought about it today, and you think you have an idea, you can raise your hand. So let's first try to figure out what Z2 gauge theory do we have. Let's forget about time reversal, forget about symmetry for now. Let's just talk about topological superconductor coupled to fermion parity gauge field, and what kind of Z2 gauge theory do we get. Okay. Anyone? Any guess? Oh. Okay, so yes. Okay, so good. That's good. I should start from there. Yes. So if we have an S-wave superconductor, an S-wave superconductor has Z2 fermion parity symmetry, and we couple it to a Z2 gauge field. And what kind of Z2 gauge theory should we expect to get? Yes, I should start from there. Thank you. Any guess? Sorry. So this is the S-wave superconductor is the simplest kind of superconductor you can think of. It doesn't have any topological structure. It's the topological counterpart of a mod insulator that I would think of, or just a simple band insulator. And in that case, we couple to a Z2 gauge field. We would expect to get the simplest kind of Z2 gauge theory. Yes, I see someone raising their hand. Yeah. Yes, good. Yes, exactly. So this is the Alexei's famous 16-fold way that Alexei talked about coupling two-dimensional superconductors to Z2 gauge field and what kind of Z2 gauge theory you get. And of course, the S-wave superconductor is the simplest one, and coupling to the Z2 gauge theory, a gauge field, results in the simplest kind of Z2 gauge theory, which is toric-coupled, we talk about there. So you can think of this this Z2 spin as this one as vacuum, this one as a Bogoliubov quasi-particle, and it's exactly the same picture. But the difference, of course, the difference is that this particle is fermion. Okay. And of course, Alexei went on to talk about the other 15 more non-trivial kind of Z2 gauge theory that you can get by coupling the simplest non-trivial one is the P plus IP superconductor, and you couple it to a Z2 gauge theory, you get an Ising, chiral Ising theory. And the gauge flux is actually non-abelian, it's the Majorana mode, and that's what everyone is after, of course, in different ways, either in 1D or 2D or on 3D surface. Yes, so if we take an S wave superconductor coupled to Z2 gauge field, and the gauging procedure is exactly the same. We take some hopping and pairing term and couple them with gauge field if necessary, and write down vertex term and Plaquette term and solve for the Hamiltonian. The superconductor is usually written in, it's very easily written in momentum space, so it's not very straightforward to see, but if you think about this picture, that it can be thought of as either vacuum on site or Bogolyubov quasi-particle on site, then it's more straightforward to see this correspondence between Ising paramagnet and S-wave superconductor. And what we get is toric-cold. And of course, now the gauge charge is the fermion. It's the Bogolyubov quasic particle of an S-wave superconductor. And the gauge flux is very trivial because there's no topological order whatsoever in an S-wave superconductor, so it's the simple bosonic gauge flux. So compared to the case of Ising paramagnet, this is actually the composite of what we wrote as E and M. So we're just calling them different names. We're calling the F anion the gauge charge. And the gauge flux is still M. Okay. All right, this is already non-trivial because now the gauge charge carries some fractional quantum number, right? In particular, on the time reversal, it transforms as t squared equal to minus 1. So this is already some symmetry fractionalization on the gauge charge part, even with a S-wave superconductor. Okay, but that's not the end. So we're talking about topological superconductor, which with time reversal symmetry is different from an S-wave superconductor, right? But first of all, let's still get back to the question of what kind of Z2 gauge theory do we get by coupling a topological superconductor to a Z2 gauge field. Now we know that what happens to an S-wave superconductor, do we know what happens to a topological topological superconductor? Yes.
Before you move on to that, I'm still a little confused about the Z2 gauging and the S-wave superconductor.
Uh-huh.
So, I mean, if I take a physical superconductor with the real electromagnetic gauge fields,
yeah, this is just saying.
I think we want to not consider that. I'm wondering whether that Z2 gauge field.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, exactly. That's the gauge flux is the pi flux.
The rest have been.
Yes. Yes. So yeah, it's the pi flux is just the gauge flux, and we know that in an S-wave superconductor, the pi flux has no extra structure like a Mironov mode or anything. Yeah, it's just a simple. Yeah,
that
a simple.
Could be confusing because real 2D superconductors live in a three-dimensional world, and real electromagnetism is three-dimensional.
Well,
that's only true if the world is two-dimensional.
Yes, 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 yes. Well, the gauge flux picture is it threads through the sample, so yeah, that still works. Yeah. Yes. Oh yes, so we're not trying to gauge T. Gauging T is a totally different topic. Okay. So in order to gauge a symmetry, we only talk about gauging for most of the part. We only talk about gauging unitary symmetry because we can write the symmetry in a certain local version. The symmetry acts as sigma x, sigma x, sigma x, sigma x, all tensor together, and we want to break it up into local pieces, we just take one sigma x, right? But time reversal is different. Time reversal acts as complex conjugation together with some spin flip. And complex conjugation is a very global action. And that's, I did something. I don't want to talk about it. not in this lecture. And there are other ways to think about it in a space-time picture. I would say it's a very interesting question. It's just beyond the scope here. All right. Okay. Still, we have this question of, if we take a topological superconductor, forget about time reversal symmetry. What happens to topological superconductor if we forget about time reversal symmetry? If we can add terms that break time reversal symmetry, what happens to a topological superconductor? Yes. Yes, so topological superconductor is topological only if we keep time reversal symmetry, right? The edge mode is Majorana mode moving this way with spin up, Majorana mode moving this way with spin down. If we don't care about time reversal symmetry, we can totally induce some backscattering between these two edges and gap it up. Okay, so topological superconductor is a different phase from S-wave superconductor only if time reversal symmetry is preserved. If we forget about time reversal symmetry, it's just an S-wave superconductor. Okay, and when we talk about coupling it to a Z2 gauge field, if we just want to know what kind of quasi-particle statistics is in the Z2 gauge theory, then we can first of all forget about time reversal symmetry, because time reversal symmetry is something add on to the topological order of the Z2 gauge theory. It's something that enriches the topological order, the symmetry enriched topological phase. But if we just want to know what kind of quasi-particles, what kind of statistics, what kind of anions we have after gauging, then we first forget about forget about time reversal symmetry, and then topological superconductor is equivalent to an S-wave superconductor, and the result of gauging is the same. Okay, we take a topological superconductor, couple it to a Z2 gauge field, we get toric-coat type of topological order. We have fermionic gauge charge, we have bosonic gauge flux, and the quasi-particle content is just E and M and F and nothing. So this is the first step. This is the quasi-particle content of the symmetry-enriched topological phase. Okay. All right. Good. Yes.
To make sure you have not yet talked about the details how you exactly gauge the fermion.
I don't want to.
Sure, I just
want to
make sure you didn't.
I don't plan to. Yeah, sorry. So so you can go read Alexei's 16-fold way, or you can just take an S-wave superconductor and couple and see for yourself. The as simple as you can make the wave function like a product state. Yeah. Right. So we figure out the quasi-particle content. So this is toric-coat, and it will be toric-coat enriched by time reversal symmetry, right? So, and the only thing we're left to figure out how do the quasi-particles transform under time reversal symmetry? And we already know how one of them transform. This Bogoliubov quasi-particle, we know how it transforms. It transforms as t squared equal to minus 1. Right. Yeah, that's just because we started from this matter field and the symmetry transformation carries over to the gauge charge. And we're left to figure out how E and M transform on the time reversal symmetry. Okay. And that's actually a pretty interesting case. Okay. So in order to think about that, it is helpful to go back to this picture of topological superconductor. Now we have a layer of P plus IP on top and a layer of P minus IP on the bottom. And remember that gauge flux corresponds to symmetry flux. The property of gauge flux is inherited from the property of symmetry flux. So if we want to think about how a pi flux, a Z2 gauge flux, transform here, we can just think about how the pi flux, the symmetry flux, transform individually in the P plus IP superconductor and P minus IP superconductor, and then put them together. Okay. So what happens in the pi flux of a P plus IP superconductor? Yes, exactly. In a P plus IP superconductor or in a P minus IP superconductor, there's a Majorana core, right? That has been talked about too many times in this lecture. So for Majorana mode, we will write a gamma here and another gamma here. But of course, these two gammas are different. One is with spin up, one is with spin down, right? Because this is a toy model. We think about when we think about topological superconductor that this is a P plus IP for spin up and P minus IP for spin down. That's why the edge mode is left mover with spin up and right mover with spin down. So correspondingly, the core Majorana mode also carry the spin degree of freedom. Okay. So put them together. In the core of a pi flux of this gauged topological superconductor, we have two Majorana modes. And that's good, because we don't want odd number of Majorana mode in the gauge flux of a toric code, right? In the toric code, gauge flux are just bosons. They're E and M. They're bosons. They're not non-abelian quasi particles. They're pretty much abelian. But of course, here we have two Majorana modes, and together they form a fermion mode, and that's in this core of the pi flux. And this is a two-dimensional Hilbert space, actually, right? So two dimensions differed by this fermion parity of this pi flux in the core of the pi flux. This is how we write the fermion parity for a fermion mode composed of two Majorana modes, right? And it is two-dimensional, actually, because it contains both E and M. So both of them are here. Each one of them is an abelian quasi-particle and accounts for one dimension. If you put them together, they become this two-dimensional stuff. All right, now we can try to see how it transforms under time reversal symmetry. Well, time reversal, we know how time reversal transforms on these kind of things. Time reversal just acts on the spin labels, right? It takes spin up to spin down, and spin down to minus spin up. So gamma up to gamma down, and gamma down to minus gamma up. Okay, just in the same way as the fermions transform. All right, and what does that mean for the fermion parity in the core of the pi flux? This one transforms as first, I becomes minus I, right? That's the complex conjugation part of time reversal symmetry. And gamma up goes to gamma down, and gamma down goes to minus gamma up. And if we put it together and do some algebra, if I did it right, it's minus parity. So this is a two-dimensional Hilbert space associated with the pi flux. And the fermion parity changes sign on the time reversal symmetry. Yes? Yeah, they do anti-commute. That's why I get a minus sign. So there's a minus here and minus here, and then they anti-commute. So I have a minus sign in total. Right. So this is a very special way for time reversal to act. Yeah, in the original symmetry, for the original fermion, time reversal doesn't change fermion parity, right? It just flips the spin. But of course, this fermion mode is not the original fermion mode. It's some composite fermion mode made up by two Majorana modes. This thing actually happens on the edge of a 1D topological superconductor chain. It's the in 1D we can have a non-trivial topological superconductor with time reversal equal to minus one as well, and that's exactly what happens there. That we have a Majorana chain with spin up, and a Majorana chain with spin down, and time reversal acts as spin up to spin down and spin down to minus spin up. This is a non-trivial phase with t squared equal to minus 1 in one dimension. And the same thing happens here in the core of the topological superconductor. That fermion parity gets reversed on the time reversal symmetry. Okay. Okay. So you can interpret this as some fractional way that symmetry can act, because originally time reversal does not anti-commute with fermion parity. Here it does. Yeah. Yeah, so okay. So this is still in terms of P plus IP superconductor and P minus IP superconductor, in terms of how symmetry acts in the core of the gauge flux, right? And now we need to translate things into how symmetry acts on the quasi-particles of the gauged Z2 theory. And we know that the core actually is composed of a composite of E and M. And we know that under time reversal symmetry, somehow fermion parity is flipped. So how does E and M transform on the time reversal symmetry here? Yes? E and M? So, so you want E to be something like a spin up, and M to be something like a spin down. And I think your point is that E maps to M, and M maps to something like a minus E, something like that. Yeah. Okay, yeah. So first of all, it's a good observation that E and M is switched. Okay. Because E and M differ by a fermion, right? If you fuse a fermion with E, you get a M. If you fuse a fermion with M, you get an E. So if fermion parity is changed on the time reversal symmetry, then E and M are actually flipped. So E and M actually, one of them correspond to no fermion, one of them correspond to fermion, although there's no absolute way to say which one corresponds to which. Okay. And regarding this minus sign, that I don't know, I need to think about it. T squared. I don't think there's a minus sign here. So first of all, we don't need to worry about these two-fold Hilbert space splitting in degeneracy, because these two are different after gauging. there are different super selection sectors. So there are different quasi particles, and we can't map from one to the other under local transformation. So we don't actually need AT squared equal to minus one symmetry to protect it, to protect the degeneracy between them. And then on the other hand, let me think for 5 seconds. Oh, okay. I think it doesn't make sense to say whether there is a minus sign here or not, because we can just add some phase factors here. Or let's see, we can add, we can redefine the fields as, we add some phase factors in front, and then we can get rid of, so if originally E is to M, then now E is to minus I M, and M goes to, I guess I confused myself, but okay, the point is, okay, let me get back to you about whether there should be a minus sign. I think I'm, I need to think about it when I'm off stage. Okay. Okay. Yes.
All right, so you were mentioning the two-dimensional Hilbert space by the combination of my rock.
Yes.
Somehow corresponds to the two charges. But the EMF, they use, they're appealing, so they don't, like, what sense is this Hilbert space, on the level of the Hilbert space, in what sense do you mean by this, what do you mean by this correspondence?
Right, so the two-dimensional Hilbert space is before gauging. That's in the P plus IP, it's in the topological superconductor. And after gauging, they actually correspond to different topological sectors. And when I say that, it doesn't mean that they fuse together. Of course, when they fuse together, they become this fermion. But this is like they exist on top of each other. So they're just two different possibilities for the realization of gauge flux, and time reversal will switch one to the other. Yeah, I hope that's clear. Yes.
So when you say F transforms like T squared equals minus one, are you saying that the two Fs, like F?
Oh, yeah. Right. So the F have some internal spin label, but that's not a topological label. That's a local spin label. So that can be flipped locally. And that transforms as T squared equal to minus one. And that gives you a twofold degeneracy on the time reversal. But both F up and F down correspond to the same quasi particle. They're both Bolgogol of quasi particle, and you can just flip the spin. Make sense? Or that's not your question?
It is.
Well, it's like this. This pseudo spin. This pseudo spin picture of the hardcore boson. So the pseudo spin some internal degrees of freedom of the boson. So even after gauging, they don't become different quasi particles. They're still the same quasi particle, but with some spin degree of freedom.
By non-local properties, so any local property would not have
labels. Yeah, so this, yeah, globally they look the same. If you do braiding experiments, they look the same.
So you're saying this is S, by S, what do you mean, the fermion parity symmetry or the time reversal?
By S? Sorry. So this is a Z2 gauge theory, Torrey code. Torrey code type of topological order with E, M, and F quasi particle plus time reversal symmetry. And in such a way that time reversal exchanges ENM with up to a minus sign, think about it. And also fermion acts as T squared equal to minus one. This is the symmetry in fractionalization pattern of this Z2 gauge theory under time reversal. And we obtain that by gauging the topological superconductor. If you think about the question just from here, that you take a toric-coat model with time reversal symmetry, and you ask, well, you don't literally take the toric-coat model, you take models in the same phase as the toric-coat model, which has time reversal symmetry. And you ask, can the ENM quasi-particle be exchanged on the time reversal symmetry? That's not totally clear. We thought about it, actually. We thought about it for a while. We thought maybe not. The reason maybe not, I will talk about it in the next time, because a lot of them, a lot of these symmetry-enriched topological phases can be written down using transcendent theory. You write the topological order using transcendent theory. You describe the symmetry transformation as transformation on the transcendent gauge field. And if you do that, you don't get this. And of course, there's a reason that you don't get this, because it's somehow not abelian. But if you don't get something from transcendent theory, it seems to be hinting that there's a problem with it. And there may be an anomaly. It may be not doable. But actually, that's only because the limitation of transcendent description. And actually, from thinking about topological superconductor and thinking about gauging it, we actually get this as symmetry fractionalization pattern where E and M are exchanged. Yes, and this is legitimate because they have, they're both bosons. Okay. So, yeah, it's just saying that you. Yeah, it is it changes the fermion number, fermion parity, indeed. Yeah. Yeah, the fermion just disappears in some sense. Yeah. Sorry, what was the question? Okay. Yes.
So S wave and P wave both go to toric code, but somehow these must be different.
Sorry. P wave goes to Ising if you gauge it. As your first sentence was S wave and P wave goes.
We had these two layers. You just said that they also.
If you have two layers, one is P plus IP, P minus IP, then you go to toric code, yes.
And then S wave also.
Yes.
But somehow these toric codes are different because the way they act.
Yeah, because time reversal symmetry is
okay, so what
acts
exactly
differently.
Is the difference?
Oh,
how
okay.
Does it act on the top?
Yeah, on the top, it's just the gauge charge transforming as T squared equal to minus one. The gauge flux doesn't do much.
So E doesn't go to M.
Yes.
Here, but it goes to M at the bottom.
Yes. Okay. Yes. Yes, exactly. That's the difference, yeah.
So here T squared is one on E and M.
That's the question I want to think about. I want to think about offstage. Yeah. Okay, sorry.
So
yes.
Phenomenological question.
Yes.
Time reversal is not an operation one can implement in the laboratory.
Yeah, okay.
So probing the bulk of these phases, how do we tell that they're different?
You mean topological superconductor and S wave? Oh, I see. Yeah, I think you have you would have degenerate modes in the Pyflux core,
you're
right?
Yeah. The rock
mode. Yeah.
Yes. Can you say, I'm still kind of trying to understand, in what sense time reversal symmetry. So you have an extra.
Yes.
You would say the charges.
Yes. Yes.
Local.
Right.
Have local, have fractional charges, rather than to the, as compared to the local.
Right, this is a very good point. I should have said that. So when from the beginning of the lecture, when we talk about symmetry fractionalization, we always talk about fractional quantum number, we talk about one third charge, we talk about one half spin. But this is the first time actually we see that symmetry exchanges type of quasi particles. Right, this is just a more complicated way of symmetry to act on a topological state. I would call it symmetry fractionalization, even though it's not in the strict sense of fractional quantum number. It's just non-trivial ways for symmetry to act on the quasi-particles. This is a very, very non-trivial way. Actually, I'm going to stay away from it for the rest of the lecture. But this is a very good example to keep in mind when you try to think about symmetry exchanging quasi-particle type. It definitely can happen. It's just the theory becomes more complicated if you want to talk about what is the consistency condition for this type of transformation patterns. How to detect anomaly for this kind of pattern. It just becomes way more complicated. So, yeah. This is one copy of P plus IP, one copy of P minus IP to cancel the chirality. Right. Yes. So
is this a unique outcome, this fractionalization pattern?
Yes. This is the outcome of gauging a topological superconductor. Yes.
The fractionalization already happens in the meta theory.
In the what? Yeah. The gauge charge is already t squared equal to minus one, but on the gauge flux, it's just a more amazing way of fractionalization.
Must you always have directed representation in the meta theory?
No, not necessarily. Yeah, you can have like I don't have an example on top of my head, but I don't think that's a constraint. Yeah. Yes.
Right. So you didn't gauge T because it was non-local. It's hard. But say you have a T4 symmetry, and you gauge so it's generated by something R, where the fourth R to the fourth is one.
Yeah.
You decide to gauge R squared instead of R.
Yes.
And then look at, so then you get some gauge thing, and then you look at how R acts on quasi particles.
Mm-hmm.
Does the same pattern sort of help you? Does the same pattern exist? Does it help you distinguish patients?
Yeah. You can always take a bigger symmetry, a big symmetry group, gauge a subgroup of it, and then the quotient group becomes your global symmetry.
Okay.
And
look at how that acts.
Yes. So here, originally, we kind of started from a Z4 gauge field, a symmetry group, right?
Yeah.
Because T squared equal to fermion parity squared equal to 1. And we gauge the Z2 part, and we are left with the Z2 for the time reversal part. So after gauging, time reversal becomes a Z2 symmetry. Yes. And to your question about whether the gauge charge has to transform non-trivially under symmetry in order for gauge flux to transform non-trivially, the answer is no, because this exchange of E and M can also happen for unitary Z2 symmetry. And in that case, the gauge charge doesn't have this square equal to minus one structure. Yeah, the answer is no, because if I understand your question, if I replace time reversal with unitary Z2 here, this thing can also happen, that E and M gets exchanged. But in that case, the gauge charge doesn't have to transform in this way. For time reversal, it has to transform in this way. For reason I don't have time to talk, but for unitary, it doesn't have to be fractional or anything. Okay.
Yes,
yes, definitely. I finally got to the homework.
Okay, well, let's thank
F 是等于 EM 吗？在哪？
啊？我等一下，我把这个关上。